living. So I want to now to go to the okay, here I was at that no, my goodness. Oh. Okay. This is the second Marshall number. So this is a, for those who are interested in experiments, they should pay attention to this difference, and they should really understand first, doing an experiment, these subtleties here. And I can tell you that not all the experimentalists have understood this kind of thing. So this is an advice I give to you. If you do experiment, if you want to measure Marshall number experiment, try to understand what I what is written here or in the paper, because it is important. Now, let me go to the second instability, which is the thermodiffusive instability of planar frame. I mentioned the work of Sivashinsky, but you know, before Sivashinsky, the situation was confusing because people say, oh, the frame is unstable when Lewis number is larger than one. And other people found, oh, the frame is unstable when Lewis number is smaller than one. What does that mean? That means, and this is very interesting, is that the stability domain where the frame is thermodiffusively stable is near Lewis equal one. Is the difference Lewis minus one is small. And this is why people before, you know, did not succeed to discriminate between the instability for large Lewis number and the instability for small Lewis number. There is a range of Lewis number close to one where the frame is stable. And I want to show you, to describe this. I am not sure that I will have time. We will see what if I am going to skip too much or not. I will see. In order to study this problem, it's in order to understand the diffusive effect, we just have just kill the hydrodynamical effect. You know, in order to understand the effect of the diffusion, kill the hydrodynamical effect. So this is a very tough approximation. It's a very strong approximation, assumption, you know, which is not realistic. Frame, you cannot say that there is no hydrodynamic instability because you are. But it is instructive to understand the mechanism of the instability, of this instability. This is what Sivashinsky did. And also Zeldovich did some work about that in before, but you know it was difficult to understand clearly the, what was the result. If you kill if you kill the hydrodynamical effect, you kill the fluid mechanical effect. Because you assume, you say density is constant. This is quite impossible because the temperature is varying and you have pressure is constant. So this is not a realistic approximation, but it is an interesting approximation to understand the physics of the competition of the different physical mechanism that result in an instability of the frame. And an instability mechanism, which is very interesting, as I will explain to you. Now, so we use rho constant. We kill this, this equation of state, and we kill the fluid mechanical problem. So when you do that, here are the equations. Now, you have killed here in the particulate derivative the flow. So you have only the partial derivative, with respect to time here, and I have simplified the problem by taking out unusual unusual variation of quantity. So I will assume here that the diffusion coefficients are constant. The only difference, and I use also the Zeldovich model of one step irreversible in the limit of large activation energy. But here is a key point that we have well pointed out with Guy Joulin. This was part of his thesis for the Guy Joulin. One has to be careful when taking this limit large activation energy now, because it turns out that the interesting domain for the diffusion coefficients is of order 1 over beta, is very small. So we have to use what is called in mathematics a distinguished limit. Let's go to infinity, the activation energy, but the difference between the two diffusivity, you assume they are as small as 1 over beta. This is, in fact, the key point of the analysis. And this took some time to realize that. It took time for the people to understand that, even for us. So before to go to this analysis, let me tell you how the solution of Zeldovich is working when the Lewis number is different or 1, because what I gave to you is the result of Zeldovich for Lewis equal 1, all right? And do you know who did that first? Lewis different from 1? Lev Landau. You know, so this one has understood the work of Zeldovich. He understood very clearly. Maybe he was the only one in the world that understood what did Zeldovich and Franz Kamineski. Lev Landau he has a paper where he shows what is the effect of Lewis number different from 1. And he was a little bit caustic. You say caustic? He say, why Zeldovich did not do that? It's so simple. You know, there was competition between Zeldovich and Landau, but nice competition. It's fair thing. So just to tell you, you know, here are the equation now in the reduced form, okay, of the frame with the Lewis number equal different from 1. Now, the only thing it's easy, effectively, to solve this problem is that in the reaction layer, you kill the convective effect. And now you see that in the reaction layer, you have this relation. The temperature and the reduced temperature and the reduced mass fraction are linked by this, in such a way that you may integrate that across the layer. And you find out that theta in the side Zeldovich number, you are going to find that psi is related to theta minus 1 with the Lewis number. You know, because you it's not equal to 1. When you integrate that, you obtain theta plus 1 over Lewis, psi equal to 1 over Lewis, equal to 0. So you have this, and you put that here, and now this psi is not equal to 1 minus theta. It's equal to Lewis 1 minus theta. And so the result, when you reduce the result with the flames, with the value of the flame speed equal to Lewis 1, you have simply square root of Lewis. And you have square root of Lewis if the order of the reaction is unity. If the order of reaction is n, 2, 3, 4, you got here Lewis n divided by 2. That's all. Very simple. Okay? This is why Landau was kidding. Okay. But this is you may reduce the energy. It's an excellent exercise for you, for those who are interested to do this carefully. Now, what I want to show is the following. You know, when the Lewis number is different from unity, and when you wrinkle a flame, you have a I hope that there is a picture. I know. So, where is the picture? Voilà, no, not this one. So when you wrinkle the, when you wrinkle the flame, you have this transverse diffusion, diffusive flux that are coming from the shift of the longitudinal gradients or longitudinal profiles of temperature. It's a pity that I do not have the picture here. So, because, in other words, this is the reaction rate. This is the limit of the preheated zone. And you see here you have the temperature profile, just like that, and the density and the special profile. Now, when you shift this, you see you have in that direction here, you have a flow, a diffusive flux of heat flux in the transverse direction. And you have an opposite flux, okay, no color. This should be dot because it is, this should be this one. And you have an opposite flux when you shift, you see, because here it become clear, you know, here the mass flux is larger at that point than at that point. So you are going to have a flux in that direction. So you have competition between between the molecular flux and the thermal diffusive flux in the transverse direction to find finally what is going to be the temperature here, the flame temperature. Because you are changing the flame temperature because of the transverse. So this is what is written here. And you know, here is a key point. The asymptotic analysis, I don't like too much to use this term because this is too pretentious. But because, you know, beta large, the limit beta, the activation energy going to infinity should be such that the flame temperature should not vary much more than 1/beta. Why? This is simple. It is because, remember, you have something like exponential theta minus 1. If you have a variation of the temperature which is larger than 1/beta, you have a transcendental large or small term depending if theta is larger or smaller. So this is going to destroy every perturbation analysis because it is exponentially strong. So in order to kill this possibility, you should assume that the flame temperature, the variation of the flame temperature, should be such that this is not larger than unity to avoid to have transcendently large term in the limit beta goes to infinity. And this is possible only if the competition, transverse competition, is small. Which does that mean? It means that the Lewis number minus 1 should be a small number of order 1/beta. And this is a distinguished limit that we have defined. Guy Joulin did that very well in his PhD thesis. Now, let me go to the analysis of the thin reaction layer of a curved flame. The thin reaction layer is quasi-planar, because you know the curvature effects are outside. The flame thickness, the thickness of the reaction zone is small. It's 1/beta compared to this thickness. So you may neglect the transverse, this effect inside. You know, this transverse flux are not important when the thickness is very small. So you neglect this effect inside the reaction. And so the reaction zone has exactly the same type at the planar one. The only difference now is that the flame temperature is not given. This is going to result from the competition of the transverse diffusion in the preheated zone, in the external zone. So when you do that, this is easy. You know, theta, I introduce this big, big, capital theta, capital psi here, which is the difference between the flame temperature and so on. So here are the equations you have to solve, and these equations are exactly, and now you obtain the jump condition across the reaction layer. And it's not necessary to get lost in the details. Simply, you have to keep in mind the result. The result is the following. The temperature gradient leaving the reaction zone is simply proportional to this term beta. Where is it? Here, divide by 2, but there is a division, divide by 2 here because it is a square root. Okay, this in fact is a Arrhenius law, is an exponential dependence, strongly varying reaction rate with the temperature. This is nothing else or more than the Arrhenius law. Tells you what is going to be the flux going out from the inner reaction layer to warm up the premixed gas. And now you have another relation, which that you obtain immediately from here. You know, yes, you just integrate that because you have take out the reaction rate disappear, so you have this relation. And it turns out, and this is important, it turns out, and it is a very, let's say, a little bit subtle, that this reaction, this relation here is valid up to first order in the analysis of 1/beta. This one is valid at the leading order, let's say when order 1. This one is valid up to the order 1/beta. And this is why you can compute with it's possible, this is in the thesis of Guy Joulin, and this is why you, but it is also in this paper, okay? So for those who are interested, you have a look at this paper, you will understand immediately how it works. It's not easy to read the paper, but it is there. Because many people, you know, for example, Zeldovich used this relation, but it does not say anything about the validity of the equation, up to what expansion it is valid. It turns out to be valid up to the first order approximation. So, in fact, this is going to give you the flame temperature. So, the preheated zone in the non-dimensional analysis are written here. You know, you have the ancillary term, convective term, diffusive term, the Lewis number, same equation, but with a Lewis number, which is different from unity. So one asks, okay, it's better to work in the reference frame attached to the reaction zone. So it is better, you know, if I call A eta tau the equation of the inner of the layer here, the inner layer here. This is the equation of the surface. It is useful to work in the reference frame of that. And so you use the change of coordinate. And here is the result for the external linearization of the external equation. They are easy to understand. This is unsteady term. This is a longitudinal convection. This is longitudinal diffusion, transverse diffusion. Lewis number is one for the temperature. And now you have an extra term. Where this extra term is coming is coming from the change of coordinate. That's all. It's not very difficult. And the same thing for the psi, for the. And so you have this external equation. Now, this can be easily solved in that form. You use, as usual, what you use is the Fourier decomposition for the transverse variable and the time, or it is maybe a Laplace transformation for the time, but this has no importance. So you have this now. This is the reduced growth rate, this strange beast here. I don't know what the number, what is the name of this letter. I don't know. Because, you know, I don't know. I will call that sigma. I don't know what it is. So this reduced sigma, say. This reduced sigma here is the reduced growth rate. And kappa is the reduced wavelength. And here is a decomposition that you use for the equation. You have an amplitude here, which is not important because this amplitude is going to be eliminated because you are linear. So you have the amplitude everywhere. So this is why I put the amplitude in the temperature, you know, in the coefficient. I put the amplitude because this is going to be simplified in the linear approximation. And I am interested to find the sigma. And this same thing, this is for the flame temperature. This is for the flame temperature does not depend on psi. And this is a field temperature, is a temperature in the preheated zone that depends on the transverse coordinate, the longitudinal coordinate. And in the transverse, you have the Fourier. You decompose the Fourier. And same thing. And when you do that, you transform your a partial differential equation in ODE. This is the key point of the Fourier decomposition. So you have now ODE to solve, and this ODE can be solved easily because they have constant coefficient. Second order ODE, but with constant coefficient, and this is easy to solve. What is difficult, you may get some difficulty if the coefficients are varying. But as soon as the coefficients are constant, all ODE are easy to solve. Analytically, I mean, so to get an expression. So here is the equation that you have to solve. You see the only difference, again, is in the Lewis number here. All right, for the moment, I did not put Lewis number small, close to one, so I have to put that later on. Yeah. Okay. Now you have the jump condition and the boundary condition at infinity, which assumes that there is no disturbance at infinity. So this is the equation. Now kappa, the wave number, reduced wave number is given. And now you have two unknowns that are the growth rate and the flame temperature that you do not know. And in the external field, what is this? This is a particular solution of this equation. The particular solution of this equation, and you take, you know, if you take this as a solution, this term disappears and you have a particular solution. So you have the particular solution for this, because you have this equation, our ODE, with a source term here, and the particular solution are given here. And your boundary conditions, temperature should be zero, and variation of temperature should be zero. At the frame, psi equals zero. You remember, we are working in the frame linked to the reaction rate, so that this xi, zeta equals zero is at the frame. So this is the frame temperature. And now here are the solution. This is a general solution to the homogeneous equation, where the homogeneous equation is with this. This is easy to solve. Here's the equation. Okay, this is purely, is very simple. These are you have a second order different, a second, an algebraic equation of the second order for this exponent r plus minus you obtain. And the mass fraction in the the reactant is completely consumed in the burned gas. That is for zeta positive, so this psi equals zero. And at minus infinity, you should have a zero also and you should have zero also for the mass rate at the flame surface, because you have consumed, you know, psi is equal to zero here. All right. Now, this is the equation, the similar solution for the perturbed reduced mass flux, is similar, except that now in this exponent here, you do not have a so simple expression, as simple as for the temperature, but you have now the same, similar with the Lewis number appearing everywhere. For the moment, I do not say anything about the Lewis number. There is here. The Lewis number is here. I did not say how large is it and so on. Let's go now a little bit further. Now, I am going, it's because I have two unknowns, flame temperature, growth rate, I need two equations. I have two equations that are the jump condition that are written here. And I am looking now to this asymptotic analysis, and now I am going to assume that the Lewis number minus one is small, so for the one of the beta, in order to have, you see, a modification of the flame temperature, which is of also of order one of beta, such that I have no transcendently small or zero term when beta goes to infinity. This is in order to have a well-defined answer when beta goes to infinity. Otherwise, I do not have answer. Yeah. Although it is zero or infinity, well, I am lost. And now the second condition here can be written in terms of the flame temperature and the two coefficients, R plus, R minus, S minus, and R plus, and so on. Forget about the detail. And this is the difference, R plus. Forget about the detail. And now you obtain the flame temperature using this approximation, this equation. And you see now that the modification to the flame temperature is proportional to Lewis minus one. And hopefully, if Lewis minus one is small, it's of order one over beta, this is one over beta, and all these terms, kappa and this strange sigma here, are of order unity, all right? This is what you obtain when you use that the Lewis number minus one is small. And now you use a linearized equation of the first of this first equation, and you obtain the expression of the flame temperature, which is here. Now you put that together, and you have a dispersion relation, which is an equation for this linear growth rate in terms of reduced linear growth rate, in terms of a reduced wave number, where what are the what is the para? There is only one parameter in this equation. Where is it? Small l, which is the difference of Lewis minus one times beta. So you have an equation here, which is it's an algebraic equation. It's not very, very, very important. It's not a very difficult equation. It's an algebraic equation that a solution of to this equation give you sigma in terms of k kappa, that is the linear growth rate in terms of the wave number, and where with a parameter in it, which is a Lewis number, minus one times beta. All right, now let me consider the case, you know, if what I am going to do is the following. I am going to say, okay, what I am interested in the transition between stable and unstable. This is what I am interested in, because I am going to simplify this expression in that case. So in order to do that, I am going to assume that when I will use a small expansion in kappa, because the sigma equals zero when kappa equals zero. So when I use a small expansion in the weakly curve limit, weakly curve, be careful, does not mean, it's not the same weakly approximation as in the lambda of Dario analysis, where there is no signess. Here, I have a finite signess, but I consider a wave number sufficiently large so that I may develop in terms the reaction rate, I may develop the reaction rate in terms of powers of kappa. And I take only the first term. And the first term is here. So the frame temperature varies like Lewis minus one, because if you put a beta, it's of order unity, and kappa. And now the order unity reduced growth rate is proportional to the square of the wave number with a coefficient here, which is minus L plus 2 divided by 2. And now, you know, this is the result of a diffusion equation, you know, sigma growth rate proportional to k squared. This is the result of typical result of a diffusion equation. But now the coefficient here you have depends on the Lewis number. And it depends more precisely on beta time Lewis minus one, Lewis number minus one. All right? And now you have, so if this beta Lewis minus one is larger than minus two, you are stable. If it is larger than minus two, if it is smaller than minus two, you are unstable. And what is the picture that you have? Here is the equation, the same equation as this one, now written in the original variable, where x equals alpha y t is the equation for the surface of the reaction zone here, and you have a different equation for this and this is because you have killed the hydrodynamic. You are only diffusive, and now you have this competition. And okay, the Markstein number is this. You are stable. You are unstable if this Markstein number here, if this number is negative. And but now, if you take into account the gas expansion and so on, you have a different expression here. I don't want to get into the details. And now you have this result here. This is the growth rate in terms of the wave number here. When the Lewis number is larger than minus two, beta Lewis minus one larger than minus two, you have a sigma proportional to k squared with a negative term. And when it is larger, now you have, if you stop at k squared, you have something that diverges when k goes to infinity, which is not satisfactory. So you have to go to the next order in expansion of k, and you obtain a saturation for the small wavelengths. To summarize, let's say that for Lewis number sufficiently larger than one, you have no thermodiffusive instability. The diffusion is stabilizing the flame, but you have unstable wavelength disturbance here as soon as the Lewin number is sufficiently small. And it is, so this was understood by Zeldovich in a book he wrote in words. He said, no equation, put in words what I just tell to you, say to you now. He said, you know, if the thermal diffusivity is sufficiently strong, we are going to have a stabilizing effect. If it is not strong enough compared to the molecular diffusion of the it is unstable. So see, he has understood the mechanism. Okay. And it is interesting to notice that this mechanism, which is a diffusive unstable, an instability mechanism due to diffusion, was understood by Turing for a quite different phenomena. He was trying to develop a model for morphogenesis. With physics equation, people were interested in how the life is developing. So before thinking about the life, of animal and so on, or vegetals and so on, you have to think to model chemical model that are going to build structure. And Turing and Turing has a paper in 50 something. I do not put 50 something, where the title is a model for morphogenesis. Turing is the genius. He was a student here for a while. He was educated in Cambridge, and there is a film of. Did you see this film recently on Turing? Yes, wonderful film. And he explained how he was able to break the German code during the war. Okay, he was a genius. Yeah, really. Unfortunately, he has problem. He has a personal problem. Okay, now if you put together hydrodynamical instability and diffusion mechanism, so the situation can be understood simply in this sketch here. You know growth rate versus the wave number. If there is no diffusion, it is like a straight line for the positive psi. You know, this is Dario-Landau. Now, if you add a stabilizing diffusive mechanism, as I showed to you in the previous lecture, when you put together the analysis, but this can be done now properly. Has been done properly. You are stabilizing the short wavelength, that is the long wave number. And if you are unstable, you begin to be more unstable than the Dario-Landau instability, and then you stabilize with a K fourth term, as I showed to you. This is a picture that you have, and this now picture can be completely described analytically, not only with one-step model, but with multiple-step model and so on. This has been done. Now, let me tell you a very, very interesting result of Sivashinsky. Sivashinsky, he left Russia about 77, something like that, 76. So he emigrated to Israel, and he was a student of Zeldovich. Yeah. He has a paper with Zeldovich. He's a very bright and nice guy. And when he went back to Western country, he he brings with him a lot of calculations that he did in Russia. With Amable Lignan and another very great scientist, Spanish, I remember at that time, 77, he showed me a first draft of this result of Sivashin. And I was completely, you know, astonished, because he was able to go a step further, taking into account the nonlinear effects, just to have an equation now that describes the final shape of the frame. Wonderful. So it was really something. It turned out to be very simple. I can explain you that in few words now. At that time, I did not understand a word. The point is the following. Remember that I have somewhere in the nonlinear equation jump condition as I've used. Remember, I have a geometrical term. You remember somewhere this is the orientation of the. And now it turns out that if you manage in such a way that the instability is sufficiently small, not very large, small, that case, the case where you are stabilized, you assume that the unstable is the growth rate is small. So that you say, okay, the growth rate is small, so the final amplitude should be also small. So if the final amplitude should be also small, this term should be also small. So you can develop this term. And the equation he obtained is exactly, you know, this equation here, the three first term, this phi, I don't know, this is the equation phi in terms of the transverse variable, and this is the equation of the front. This is the linear equation, Darieux-Landau instability, stabilizing diffusive term, and he has a geometrical term, which is in fact, my goodness. Ah, qu'est-ce que j'ai fait là? Okay, qu'est-ce que c'est ça? Okay, and this geometrical term that you have here is coming from here. For example, if you have a velocity here, you have UL times UL here. And this nonlinear term is a purely geometrical term, which is related to what I explained to you, the Huygens construction. It is related to the Huygens construction, the normal trick. So, in a sense, it's easy to. I will not do that now because it's too late. But it's not difficult to obtain now this equation. It can be done quite easily, but the original paper was difficult to understand, okay? But this equation, and this equation is only valid when the gas expansion is small, for a small difference of density, in order to have a small instability here, you know? So it is an exact equation in the double limit. Small gas expansion means flame with a small difference of temperature, which is not very, 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 very accurate, but and large Lewis number. And Lewis and beta Lewis number minus one of order unity. When you put all these things together, you obtain this equation. And this equation now was studied by using, you know, a lot of numerical calculation were devoted to this equation. And this equation described what we call a cellular flame, very well. Now, if the Marstein number is negative, now this he derives also an equation for that. He has a positive term here and a negative Laplacian psi derivative twice, you know. So, but okay. So, and this is the what now. Let me give you that there is another instability, thermal diffusive instability, that I did not present. This other instability occurs when the Lewis number is very large. This critical value of Lewis number now is close to 10. If beta is close to 10, that means that the Lewis number is close to 2, you see? And it is very difficult to have a so high Lewis number in gaseous mixture. Gaseous mixture, the Lewis number, you may go down 0.3, but you can go up 1.3, 1.4, no more. So this instability now that I am going to talk about, just to mention, but I will not present the calculation, is concerned large Lewis number, and it is an oscillatory. It is what, you know, in the United States, you call that off bifurcation. Off derived bifurcation in the 50s. Poincaré, Andronov derived this. Andronov was a Russian, Poincaré was French. They find out the off bifurcation 50 years before. So we call that. I call that Poincaré-Andronov bifurcation, not off bifurcation. Because, you know, when you have 50 years late, you cannot claim that you discover something, you know. But I can't tell you why it is like that. It is because Poincaré published that in a French journal. And he was, you know, nobody read French now. And in a French journal, and it was concerning electric circuit, you know. So the people, you know, who are interested in this kind of things are not interested in circuit, electric circuit, and they did not mention. But he found that the off bifurcation, he was the first. And Andronov, unfortunately, I did not read the paper. I read the paper of Poincaré. It's a wonderful paper. But Andronov paper is not published, it's not translated, it's in Russian, and I was not able to. It was a little bit later, not so much. So, what does that mean, Hopf bifurcation or Andronov? This means that when the real part of the linear growth rate grows to zero, that it negative, it is stable, positive, it is unstable, the imaginary part is non-zero. This is what is a Hopf bifurcation. This means that you have a oscillatory frequency of this problem. And in fact, even if you look to the one-dimensional problem, 1D, this instability will correspond to a pulsating instability of the. This is very easy. If some of you are doing numerics, playing numerics with flame, use a planar flame and use a large Lewis number. You will see the solution is going to oscillate. And this is bifurcation. This has been done. I gave that as exercise to the people, to my students who were, they were able to do to. It's not, one has to be careful with the cold boundary limit, but okay. So it's this planar pulsation, but we have a result with Guy Joulin in the thesis of Guy Joulin, PhD thesis, that if you add the heat loss, you should decrease this critical value here down to a value which is now accessible. Unfortunately, we try with our experimentalist in Marseille to find this planar instability, you know. We did not find it, but an American group find that for flame attached to a plug burner. They notice that sometimes they have this. Because, you know, when you are attached to a plug burner, it is you have a lot of heat losses going through the plug burner, which is cool, because if you do not cool the plug burner, you fuse everything. So it is cool. So you have a lot of heat losses, and so you get this done, and you have this pulsation, 1D pulsation. It is very popular, this instability is very popular, and studied at length by the people, in Russian people, working in solid combustion, solid combustion. That does exist. You know, you have some kind of phase transformation, one phase to the other phase, that propagates with diffusion and lights a flame. And this is called solid combustion. And the people found this oscillation and a lot of structure with this. Another possibility to observe this is to use a flame in a porous media. You know, you fill the porous media by gas and you ignite the gas. It turns out that heat conduction is due to the solid phase. And that is much faster than the molecular diffusion by the gas phase. So you have a very large Lewis number, and then you get this oscillation. This has been observed by different people, this oscillation. Okay. I don't think, I may try just to because now I am late by one lecture. So I have to decide I have 5 minutes just to decide what I am going to do next time. So this is the fifth lecture. Okay. Sixth lecture, what is it? Ah. Okay. No, it's, I may be, for this one, okay, I will be very fast. But not now, just I tell you the title and so on, but, okay. I just want to give you some flavor of a very important phenomena, is two phenomena that are important. Flame quenching and flammability limits. These two phenomena are very important, and I just want to tell you how you can manage, in order to have a good description of this phenomena, without a big effort, a numerical effort. So I have 4 minutes. So let me start, and we will finish next time. Ah, let me give you some story, very interesting. You know, the first scientist who described extinction through thermal loss was the famous Davy. You know, in the mines, coal mines, you know, if you know this name, there is called the Davy lamp. What is a Davy lamp? It's a safety lamp. See, it is because at that time, at the beginning of the 19th century, there was not electricity. So in order to see underground, they have gas lamp. So they have that on the tube, so on, and the gas lamp on the and this is very dangerous, because when the people, you know, digging out the coal, find a pocket of methane. You know, it's, I don't know, grisou. We say that grisou in French. I don't know how you say it. Les coups de grisou. There are many in China, even now. But when you have this methane. Developing in the gallery of the mine, with a spark, you ignite and bam, and you have a big accident. So Davy was very concerned by that, And he found a very simple trick. He takes this lamp, and around this lamp, he put a small grillage. How do you say that in English?
Shield.
How do you say?
Shield.
Shield, but transparent shield, but it's metal, you know, it's a screen. Some metallic thing like that, you see, around the flame. And why he did that? Because when you ignite inside, because the flame was inside, when you ignite inside, the flame starts, but it reaches this part here, and a lot of energy is pumped and quenched. And so this is what I am going to explain to you tomorrow morning very, very quickly, and we are going to learn. Thank you very much for your attention.